Good evening. The Murray River has reached its highest level in more than 100 years, bursting its banks and inundating homes in Echuca after a heavy downpour. But the worst is yet to come, with forecasters predicting it will hit its peak tomorrow. Lana Murphy has today's developments.
There's birds and boats, even paddle boards.
Why not? Nothing else to do.
But this isn't the Murray River. It's Pakenham Street, Echuca. On the wrong side of the man-made levee, it's going underwater fast. Some homes have turned into islands, but Eagle Baldwin's is already a swamp.
For Christ's sake, mate, you can't stay like this.
Even as the rain bared down, the 71-year-old dug his heels in.
Look at you, Eagle, you're knee deep.
That's okay.
You're all right?
Yeah. I've been worse than this.
Four generations of his family has lived in this home. There's no dry land for him or his sheep. His possessions are soaked, sewage is filling his bathtub, but he won't leave.
I don't want anybody ripping me off. I put clean socks on about every 2 hours because I can't have a shower.
Across the road, Dave Tomlins and his son are trapped by choice. River water lapping at their fence, but they have a plan.
This is only rainwater. So I'm lucky enough I've kept all this out, but if we have to go to higher ground, we'll jump up there.
Swags on roofs and tinnies in driveways, the new norm for dozens of nearby homes surrounded. The river is rising slowly, but residents are working quickly against it.
I've been here since 73, so it is worse than the two floods I've seen.
The levee was unable to hold the Murray back as it spilled over beneath the old bridge, seeping over walking tracks and creating Echuca's first waterfall. In Moama, cavities are appearing in concrete, riverside defence lines bolstered by holidaymakers.
As soon as it gets in here, it's just going to be like a big drain. It'll be like filling a sink, really.
Cabin owners dashing from Melbourne and Geelong this morning to protect their parks.
What does this place mean to you?
A lot. A lot of good memories.
We've got to do everything we can to come protect it.
The water is 1 centimetre above what it was in 1993. It's only been higher 3 times in history. The current levees didn't exist then, so what tomorrow holds is unclear.
The key thing with a major river system like the Murray River is the complexities of the many river systems that flow into it.
For most, the mood is
very anxious, nervous, just don't know what's around the corner.
But for a few, there's no stopping them, simply going with the flow.
All he wants to do is go fishing.
Cheers, mate.
Lana, how high are the flood levels at the moment?
Alicia, right now the Murray River is sitting at 94.8 metres above mean sea level, and it is only expected to rise, which is pretty terrifying when you look at what's behind me. This is a street on the unlucky side of the man-made levee they've been building in Echuca's east over the last few days. The Murray River, believe it or not, is about 150 metres down the end of the street. But residents here have watched the water rise before their eyes this afternoon, and right now they are madly pumping the water that's in their front yards back onto the street. Incredibly, there's still a pretty good atmosphere here. A few doors down, we have some residents that have set up their DJ decks. They're playing music for the neighbourhood. And on my other side, we've got residents that are still organising sandbag drops. Unfortunately, tomorrow they are bracing for the worst. It is expected to peak and rise at least another half a metre.
OK, Lana Murphy there in Echuca, thank you. And the northern Victorian town of Rochester is on edge again tonight. Adam Hegarty is there for us. Adam, what impact is the rain having?
Well, Alicia, sadly, the fear is that people could be flooded again here while they're still in the midst of a cleanup. You can see behind me here the damage to that fence, the damage caused to properties, homes, businesses here when the floods first came through. Debris from inside flooded homes still littered the street, but homes like this and properties in town are now, if you can believe it, as you'll see here, putting fresh sandbags, new sandbags there, ready to go for Monday, Tuesday. The forecast is that the flooding levels could rise again after the rain that is being forecast over the next few days, and as many as 50 homes and properties could be in line for flooding yet again. Fingers crossed, and that's the feeling here, that that is not going to get to that extent. But right now, the more immediate threat is in Kerrang, where evacuation now messages have already gone out to the point where police are going door to door warning people that the Loddon River there is now due to peak tomorrow. So they're warning residents there who are still there that if they don't get out right now, they could be isolated over the next 24 to 36 hours. The ADF are also chipping in.
We've also deployed ADF personnel into Swan Hill, and they'll work from the Swan Hill region back down chasing towards upstream into Kerrang if needed.
And Alicia, with those warnings still, as you can imagine, a lot of uncomfortable, stressed people in this part of the state.
Absolutely. Okay, Adam Hegarty, thank you. Well, nature's fury was on full display as Victoria copped a drenching. Maggie Rayworth tells us the heavy rain added extra concern to residents living in already flood-soaked areas.
In just a flash, Melbourne's weather turned. In the city, the heavens lit up. From the sky, Clarendon Street in South Bank looked more like a river. York Street claimed another casualty, a car trapped in floodwater. In Truganina, lightning struck a power pole. There was flash flooding in Carlton, while Sunshine West didn't live up to its name. But it was regional Victoria that copped the biggest downpour.
North of Geelong, 85 mil, so a significant amount of rain in a very, very short period of time. In the Hamilton area, we saw 50 to 60 mil.
The Grand Central Hotel in Hamilton, taking Watering Hole to its original meaning. Its ceiling gave way, its storeroom resembling a swimming pool.
It came down pretty quickly. It was quite heavy. I ran out there to make sure the drain was on, and I was, yeah, completely soaked by the time I came back.
The wild weather just as chaotic outside. Hamilton streets flooded, roads inundated.
She Oaks near Geelong recording around 85 millimetres, 40 of that falling in just half an hour.
In Burchett, the rain hammered down. Closer to home, the struggle for flood victims continued.
I'm a friend of a friend, so I just came to chip in.
For those still salvaging precious keepsakes, the deluge was another setback.
Just very emotional when you look in the old photos.
Here in Maribyrnong, the downpour has hindered the clean-up effort. Eager to put this chapter behind them, residents are now working through the mud and rain.
I'm worrying, I just worried that's about we flood again. I take a week off and probably a few more days next week to clean up.
The rain's going to come again this rain. Take it as it comes.
Victorians making the best of a bad situation. Sliding into the weekend, embracing the big wet. Maggie Rayworth, Nine News.
Well, the storms and lightning show also disrupted the races at Moonee Valley. But as Emily Rice discovered, punters defied the weather odds at today's centenary Cox Plate.
This spring racing carnival, punters are accessorising to stay dry and stepping out very gingerly trackside.
It's very muddy though, it's a poor choice of shoes.
The storms hit Moonee Valley Racecourse last night.
In the scheme of what's going on...
There's another one.
In the scheme of what's going on right around the country at the moment,
Horses were spooked by the lightning and thunder, forcing three races, including the Manukato Stakes, to be postponed.
That was the loudest clap of thunder I've ever heard. Yeah.
When that last bolt of lightning hit or thunder, there was a lot of carry-on. I thought they were actually taking the mickey.
Racegoers were unperturbed, partying on amid the puddles. Back at the valley this afternoon for the Great Cox Plate, the downpour did subside, but it was still damp underfoot and under bums.
The chair was wet when we got here. So I ripped out my poncho, put it back on my chair, and super easy.
There were a few weather-weary Queenslanders in attendance too.
We might be the bad luck charm, but we don't want to take the blame up.
Yeah. I just moved back from Queensland, and wherever I go, it's raining.
For many, though, the forecast failed to take the shine off their day out.
We knew the rain was coming, but the last 2-3 years that we've had with COVID and everything else going on, there was nothing stopping us from coming here today. Absolutely nothing.
The feet are already saturated. I think it's just going to keep crawling up the body, and by the end of it, I'll be flapping around like a fish on that grass.
And in true Melbourne style, the sun has now come out, making those who've dressed for wintry weather feel pretty uncomfortable.
Horses are running, drinks are free, girls are cute.
Emily Rice, Nine News.
Although skies cleared over Melbourne today, significant rain fell overnight and this morning. And Madeline Slattery is here now with all of the details for us. Maddie, which suburbs received the heaviest falls?
Well, Alicia, Melbourne's west was hardest hit, 46 millimetres at Burnside, 45 at Tullamarine, 43 at Laverton. The eastern suburbs received between 20 and 30. Geelong also received heavy falls with 46. The system delivered widespread totals of 25 to 50 millimetres across the state in the 24 hours to 9 a.m. Echuca recorded 18 and Kyabram 28. The rain contracted to eastern districts today from the mid-morning, and so far it's delivered totals of 10 to 25 millimetres. Areas east of Orbost could receive another 10 to 20 tonight. This map here illustrates the scale of the rain this month. The areas in blue have received more than 200% of the October average, and the areas in purple more than 400%, and that does include locations along the Murray. Tomorrow we are expecting falls of 5 to 10 millimetres, 25 at Mildura, but heavier rain is forecast to return on Monday with 30 to 35 millimetres through the north, so there certainly is a lot more rain still to come later.
Absolutely. All right, Maddie, we'll see you a bit later on the bulletin.
Good evening. From our northern border to the very south, floodwaters are tightening their grip on our state. And tonight, a warning, the situation is about to get a whole lot worse with a new weather system developing and the beleaguered Northern Rivers region again in the firing line.
The force and the fury of relentless rain. This is Copeton Dam in northern New South Wales, 150,000 megalitres a day spilling into the Gwydir catchment below. And it's that swollen river system causing so much damage. This bridge at Gravesend, just east of Moree, washed away by floodwaters. The town is now cut off. Evacuation warnings sent to more than 4,000 residents last night as waters began to rise.
It's heartbreaking for the town. We've had a few years of drought and we're starting to get back on our feet.
Martin Hallman is from the town of Rowena, just south of Moree. Stuck in Queensland and desperately trying to get home, a light plane is now his only option.
We need to get in there so we can sort of keep an eye on the levee bank, because if the levee bank breaches, well then we end up with like 18 to 2 inches of water through our house, which happened back in 2012.
And this is just a taste of what's to come.
In Moree, we are expecting a second peak to come through that community, and it has the potential to come very, very close to the February 1955 record.
Away from the river, saturated land is also causing trouble, a landslip cutting off the Gwydir Highway between Glen Innes and Grafton. Further north at Kareela on the Queensland border, a man and woman in their 60s were trapped in their horse float for more than 4 hours late yesterday after their ute was washed downstream.
When we first got here, the vehicle was underwater by about a metre above the roofline.
From the very north to the very south, New South Wales is being inundated.
We are quite literally sandbagging the state at present.
At Moama, flood levels are now above what they were almost 30 years ago. The swelling Murray River encroaching on border towns, this levee at Echuca unable to hold the water back. Cavities are appearing in concrete, riverside defence lines bolstered by holidaymakers.
What does this place mean to you?
A lot. A lot of good memories and, yeah.
Just how much water has already come up even before the flood peak is frightening. The edge of the Murray River usually starts a good 300 metres from here, and now it's closing in.
We take family walks over night time, have a beer in the hand, walk down, go watch all the boats stream past, but you can't do that now because we're a metre off being under.
Very anxious, nervous, just don't know what's around the corner.
The next 24 hours will be very telling for Moama, which generally is faring better than Echuca on the Victorian side. The Murray River here is still rising. It's still expected to peak tomorrow night into Monday, potentially higher than 95 metres above sea level. The water flowing through here is also moving much faster than what we've seen in recent days, suggesting that we're starting to receive a lot of that water from the Goulburn River. But Mark, no one truly knows just how much worse this could get.
Hayley, thank you. Well, now to Bianca Bowser, the State Emergency Operations Centre. Bianca, a new threat is developing in our north.
Mark, Lismore is still picking up the pieces from those major floods they experienced in February and March this year. But tonight, the community is warned another one is on the way. The SES, the Emergency Operations Centre here, bracing for what's to come. Up to 300 millimetres of rain could fall on the northern rivers tomorrow alone. The warnings are dire. There could be life-threatening flash flooding and potentially landslides as well.
There is not a single part of New South Wales that I am not concerned about at this point in time.
Mark, the response is ramping up. 100 Defence Force personnel are being deployed to the northern rivers right now.
OK, Bianca, thank you. Well, Belinda is also here in the studio. Will Sydney cop it too?
Mark, so far less than 2 millimetres has been recorded across Sydney, but there are showers moving in from the west. The Bureau says there's a high chance they will hit Sydney. This is the latest computer model showing what we can expect. There's also the chance of a storm. Right now, we have a severe thunderstorm warning for these three areas across New South Wales. Heavy rainfall possibly leading to flash flooding. Conditions remaining unstable for the next 3 days. At least a trough moving in from the west, and we've also got that low over southeast Queensland. It just depends how far south it travels. The Hawkesbury Nepean is already on flood watch, but at this stage it's only expected to reach moderate levels. I'll have the latest warnings for Sydney and New South Wales after sport, Mark.
Okay, Belinda, see you soon.